swinging, 2:40. Because of the blood, when the rolls come up, you know, I won't be there. Because of him, 2:40.
Sunday. They had it outside, which I was glad they was able to have. Amen. So So you pray for them, pray for the church there. We mentioned Brother Philip Moore, a friend of ours, was at our camp meeting last year. He is in revival this week up in Henderson, North Carolina. Pray for their revival meeting this week, if you will. Anybody else have a prayer request? Pray for Jacob. He's got to go to Wisconsin starting tomorrow. So I told him, whatever you do, don't go to Minneapolis. Go around Minneapolis. And stay away from that place. And I'd go through the country, whatever I had to do. Amen. Pray for him. This is his last week working for this company, so he's trying to get back home and be at home all the time. So you pray for him. He will find the job he needs to have. He sure appreciates your prayers. Amen. Anybody else? All right. Yes. Pray for Deborah. Oh, Taylor. Pray for Taylor. Deborah needs prayer too.
I'm not going to complain.
Pray for Taylor. She's not feeling well. She's had to go to the doctor this morning.
Pray for Anna. She's exhausted.
Yeah, pray for Anna. What did they say today about Taylor?
They said that she had a rheumatic infection.
Pray for Taylor. She needs your prayers.
She's doing a little better now.
All right. Anybody else? No? Yes.
I'm having a heart attack Thursday morning.
Pray for Sheila. Any other? All right. Well, young men, y'all come on. We'll receive the offering. You give us what we have to do. All right. Let's give the Lord a prayer. Brother David Payne, would you pray?
Lord, thank you for the good week you've given us this past week, Lord. And please bless the week to come, Lord. And thanks for the good services we had this morning, Lord. And please bless the service tonight, Lord. And please bless the offering, Lord. And if anybody here is not saved, Lord, please save me today, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Take your Bible to Romans chapter number 1, if you will. Romans chapter number 1. Try to continue. We have made it through verse 13 this morning. We've only preached 10 times out of Romans chapter 1 so far. And we should get done with the book of Romans by the time I'm 70, 75 years old, I reckon. But that's if y'all let me stay that long.
Amen.
But I want to continue on. This can't seem to get away from this today. But this morning we dealt with verses 10 through 13. And we talked about how Paul has a desire to go to Rome. He has this great desire to go. And how we ought to have a desire to go. And then we talked about he had a desire to give. He wanted to give them something spiritual. It is noble to give physical things to people that are in need. The Bible teaches us to remember the poor. But may I say it's more so to give someone something that is spiritual. Because the spiritual is eternal. And so he has a desire to go to them, a desire to give to them, and then he has a desire to glorify God through them. He may have fruit. And God is glorified through us bearing fruit. And then we talked about some other things, some various thoughts about the will of God and comfort. And then we talked about what was hindering him from getting to Rome. But yet he got there. Not like you think he would have. Well, when you're praying to go to the mission field like he was praying, he probably did not realize that it was going to take a whole lot of persecution to get where he needed to go. He was going to have to be thrown in jail. He was going to have to be shipwrecked. He was going to have to do a whole lot of things before he ever got to where God wanted him to be in Rome.
Right.
And so it takes a while sometimes to be in God's timing, he gets us there. And so tonight we want to continue with these scriptures in verse number 14. And these are some wonderful scriptures. And I wish I could really do them justice. I hope that we can say something that would be a help to us. Verse number 14, he says, I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise, to the unwise. So as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. And we'll stop reading there. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask his blessings on his word. Father, thank you tonight for the awesome privilege it is to stand before your people and read the word of God. I thank you, Lord, for these three verses that, Lord, say so much. And Lord, I pray that you would help us tonight to bring out these things that you put in our minds and our hearts. And I pray, God, they would be effectual in our walk in life as children of God. I pray that, Lord, you'd bless this service. Thank you, Father, for the good singing that's reminded us that you're coming soon. And Lord, I do pray that you'd come. Lord, our world is awful tumultuous and only going to get harder to live in this world. But Lord, we're looking forward to you coming. And Lord, I pray that you'd bless your people tonight. Help us to be doing your service while we're still here. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to look at these verses here and just look at some of the phrases he says. And he mentions here in verse 14, I am debtor. What is a debtor? A debtor is someone that is a person who owes another either money, goods, or services. If you've ever been down to the bank and signed paperwork to borrow some money, you're a debtor. You know what a debtor means in a money fashion. Nowadays, you got to sign more papers than you can imagine. We went and got some money for the van out there, and I ain't never seen the lack of paperwork you had to sign. I think it's like 25 pages. You got to sign and initial and sign and initial and sign and initial. I don't know what all that was about, but I do know this. We owe them some money. Amen. We got to pay it. Amen. We owe a debt. And a debtor is someone who owes something. It says here, one who is under obligation to do something. And I think that fits more what Paul is saying here. He said, I am debtor. He owes something to these people. He's a debtor. Now, it's not necessarily real good to be in debt money-wise. It's not really the best practice, I guess. But sometimes it is necessity. God deals with debt in the Bible. But we're all in debt when it comes to this thing called the gospel. We're in debt. We owe somebody something.
Right.
Amen? We owe people. And we need to be a paying our debt. If we don't make our payments on a monthly basis, they may give us a month, they may give us 2 months, they might even be gracious and give us 3 months. But there's going to come a time when they come and repossess what we owe them if we don't make a payment. Being in debt is what I'm saying is a serious business. We actually owe something when we are in debt. And in this particular passage, Paul is saying, I am debtor. I owe people things. And he's talking about the gospel. Who is he in debt to? He said, I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. He doesn't just owe one person. He just doesn't owe one nation. I believe he's saying, I owe everybody. I owe the Greeks, I owe the barbarians, I owe the wise, I owe the unwise. I'm a debtor, he's saying. I owe everybody. Now that ain't a good feeling when you owe everybody. But when you're talking about the gospel, he's trying to give the gospel to everyone. I'm debtor both to the Greeks. Let's think about the Greeks for a moment in the scripture. Jesus helped a Greek one time. Remember the Syrophoenician lady? Had a daughter, needed some help, something terribly bad. And the Lord Jesus helped her. Isn't that good of him? He helped her. I'm thinking Timothy in the Bible. His father was a Greek, the Bible says. And we find out that Timothy is half Greek, half Jew. But he got saved. Amen. Let's look in Romans chapter number 10. We'll see a verse here about the Greeks. I'm trying to go somewhere with this. Romans chapter 10, verse number 12. He says, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. Paul is saying, I owe a debt to the Greek. Titus was a Greek. If you read the book of Titus, you'll find out Titus was a Greek. We're talking about prominent men in the gospel ministry. Timothy, Titus. These are Greek men, or at least half Greek. And the gospel knows no barriers. It has no walls that it cannot climb. The Greek can be saved, thank God. Galatians chapter number 3. Galatians chapter number 3, he tells us a little bit more. In verse number 28, there is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. Colossians chapter 3 and verse number 11. We see here the Bible says that where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond or free, but Christ is all and in all. Paul is saying in Romans chapter 1 here in verse 14, I owe the Greeks. I was up at my dad's this past week, and some of y'all have heard me talk about my dad a little bit. My dad used to teach Greek in Duke University. And again, I remind you, he got all the brains, or my sister got all the brains and the looks. And I didn't get nothing, amen. But he taught Greek at Duke University. And we were sitting talking the other day, and I had been going through all of his books trying to get stuff sorted. And I found paperwork from college in Wake Forest, from Greek and Hebrew and all this kind of stuff. And I have no idea what to say. And I asked Dad, as we were sitting talking, I said, what was your favorite country that you traveled to? Because later on in life, he went to work with UPS, and
And he traveled all over the world. He had a management position or something, and this is what he said, Greece. I mean, just like that, Greece. I believe Paul saying here, I owe the Greeks. I got a debt I got to pay. Those Greek people, I need to pay them. I owe them. What is he owing? The gospel. The gospel. Not only the Greek, he said, I owe the barbarian. Now the Greeks, if you'll think about it for a minute, the Greeks are known for what? Their philosophy. And their smarts. And their book writings. And you got men like Socrates and Plato and Aristotle. You say, who are they? I don't know, but they're famous names. Supposedly they wrote some really nice stuff. I don't know any of it. I ain't got past Bible yet, much less Socrates, you know. But some of the most famous men in all the world come from Greek. Can I say this? He said, I not only owe the Greeks, but I owe the barbarians. Who are the barbarians? That's them uncivilized people. Back, 1800s, early 1900s, we'd call them the heathen. The heathen. We got a few of them around this world. Some heathen, amen? Very uncivilized. May I say, since we're here, what's happening in our country today? A bunch of heathens doing that. Amen. They're uncivilized, burning people's stuff down.
Yeah.
Amen. Sure. I'm trying not to go into racism as best I can. I don't think this is about racism at all. You got a bunch of people out there trying to tear everybody's stuff up and steal it. That's all that is. But anyhow, he owes the barbarians. Who is a barbarian? A man in his rude, he's in a savage state, an uncivilized person. It can mean a foreigner. And Paul said, you know what? I not only owe that Greek man, but I owe this barbarian man. He's just as much in debt to the poor, uncivilized man as he is to the Greek philosopher of his day. I'm still going somewhere. Acts chapter number 28. I noticed this. Paul was talking about these barbarous people. Acts 28 verse 1, and said, and when they were escaped, this is when they were shipwrecked on the island, then they knew that the island was called Melita. Notice what it said in verse 2, and the barbarous people. We're talking about a bunch of uncivilized folk. Showed us no little kindness, meaning they showed them a lot. For they kindled a fire and received us everyone because of the present rain and because of the cold. These barbarous people were being far kinder to him than his own people. His own people wanted to kill him. But these uncivilized barbarians over here tried to help him. Isn't that strange? Isn't that strange? He tried to help them. And when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and laid them on the fire, there came a viper out of the heat and fastened on his hand. And when the barbarians, there it is again, saw the venomous beast hang on his hand, they said among themselves, no doubt this man is a murderer, whom though he hath escaped the sea, yet vengeance suffered not to live. You could tell they were living in an idolatrous state or a crazy type religion state. They're not trying to philosophize it like the Greek was going to do. I said, man, that guy's a murderer. he had to do something really bad. He escaped the sea, but boy, the snake got him. We find through the rest of chapter 28 that God uses Paul in a great way on this barbarous island of Melita. And many, many people get hear the gospel. What is he doing? He's in the will of God. He's been shipwrecked. He's on his way to Rome. Finally. And he gets to stop off by Valletta to make a payment. He gets to make a payment on the debt that he owes. Amen. That's what he's doing. He's paying his debt when he gets to Valletta. And barbaric. He said, I owe him. I'm a debtor. He said, I'm a debtor not only to the Greeks and the barbarians, but I'm a debtor to the wise and the unwise. What difference does education make? Brother W.S. said this a while ago, we were talking. He said, they say we're one of the most educated generations in the world. But we're about the dumbest people I've ever seen. And that's about the truth. Amen. We got more education running out of our ears. But man, we can sure do some dumb stuff, can't we? Paul said, I'm a debtor to the wise and to the unwise. Pretty big debt, isn't it? Now, I've owed a few things in my life. I've owed a credit card. I've owed some bank stuff. And I'm going to tell you what, it's tough if you owe everybody. And Paul says, I owed everybody. In general, that's what he's saying. I owe the Greek. I owe the barbarian. I owe the wise. I owe the unwise. What are you saying? We owe a debt. Paul's not the only one that owes this debt. You're saved by the grace of God. I'm saved by the grace of God. I like what Brother Homer said years ago. He said, it's the responsibility of every generation to win their generation. That's a big mouthful. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. We owe a debt. Yes, we support missions. We've got a few missionaries back on the board, and I thank God for that. I'm glad our church, as far as I know, ever since its conception, has been involved in missions, giving to missions. I thank God that we can go into missions. We've got men in our church that are missionaries that are going to a foreign land. Preach the gospel. Glad I can be a part of that. But can I say I still owe this debt too? You and I still owe this debt, not just to pay in money. I heard a man say years ago, he said it sometimes seems like we're serving God with our pocketbook and that's it. And there's a lot of truth to that sometimes. We think, well, I've paid my debt. I'll give my money to missions this week, and I'm okay. Now, we owe a bigger debt than that. We owe a debt to a talent. We owe a debt to gas. We owe a debt at our workplace, don't we? Yeah. Amen. You may be the only witness they see. We used to think in America, everybody's heard the gospel. No, they ain't. Not anymore. That ain't so no more. There's a lot of people in our country have never heard a clear presentation of the gospel. We owe a debt. Paul said, I am debtor. I owe a debt. Now let's look at how he paid me. How did he pay his debt? He says, so as much as in me is, I'm ready to preach the gospel to you that are in Rome also, or at Rome also. How did he pay his debt? He preached it. I like what Brother Gary Crisp said a couple of years ago. Every preacher needs a preacher. Boy, ain't that so. Every preacher needs a preacher. They may not want one. They may not think they need one. But every preacher needs a preacher. And Paul says, as much as in me is, everything I've got, he says, I'm ready. I'm ready, he said. I'm ready to go. I want to preach to them. I'm ready. I'm going to give it everything I've got. Now, a lot of people are looking for a ministry. They're looking for accolades or whatever. But if you want to preach, there's plenty of places to preach. Amen? There's a whole lot of places to preach. Most people just want to preach in church. Now, being the pastor now, that's where I do most of my preaching. But as a young preacher, most of my preaching was not in the church. Most of mine was on the street corner, in the nursing homes, in the jails. And I still like to do that kind of stuff. Why? Because I'm a debtor. I owe the guy down in jail just as much as I owe you. Amen. I owe that. I owe the folks at the nursing home. I owe the folks riding up down the street. Lord knows I need to get to paying my debts. As much as in me is, I'm ready to preach. I don't think I've ever met Brother Fielder and him not be ready. Ain't that something? He's always ready. Amen. I come back, we had talked last Sunday, they were here Sunday night, and I said, he had made mention, he said, been the longest time he'd ever been without preaching, I guess. And the more I got to think about that, and I walked up to him and I said, well, how ready are you? And he said, well, let me go to the car. I'll get my notes. He's ready. I've never met Brother Gary Follow not ready. He's always ready. Amen. Whether God's in it or not, he's ready. I'm kidding about that. Brother Gary is ready to preach, isn't he? We ought to be ready. As much as in me is. Now, you say, preacher, I'm not calling a preacher. Well, we could testify. Yeah. Amen. Ain't no telling what your preaching can do on the job. Seen several people get saved in a testimony service. It wasn't my preaching that got it done. It was your preaching that got it done.
Yeah.
Anybody?
Yeah.
Your preaching. Paul said, I'm a debtor. How's he going to pay this debt to these all these people that he knows or even don't know? He's going to preach to them. How are we going to pay this debt? We can preach to them. Notice what it said in verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. The gospel of Christ. See, I'm not ashamed of that. I'm afraid we live in a day and time where a lot of folks are ashamed. We ain't got nothing to be ashamed of. If you're a child of God, you have nothing to be ashamed of.
No.
Not one thing. Unless you're living in sin. I'm trying to be nice tonight. I've rubbed this morning, so I'm trying to be nice tonight. I'm not ashamed, he says. I'm not ashamed of this. This is what had rescued his life. He was traveling down the road, going to persecute God's children, and God's gospel came to him and saved his wretched soul. He said, man, I'm not ashamed of that. God has saved him. We're not to be ashamed of being saved.
Amen.
We're not to be ashamed of what the gospel has done in my life or your life. Personally, I was in Germany. About all y'all heard that before. I remember sitting on about the third row back, we had hard plastic chairs. And I was sitting there, I'd been there a few weeks, and that preacher got to preaching, and boy, God got to coming down my row. And I went to that altar that Sunday morning, February the 8th, 1987. And I got gloriously saved because of the preaching of the gospel. That gospel is what turned my life around. That gospel is what kept me from continuing on and becoming a sock drunk. That gospel is what changed my life forever. I'm not to be ashamed of that. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Notice what he said, for it is the power of God. It's the power of God. Listen, we don't need a new scheme. We don't need a new remedy. We don't need a new program. We need the gospel. That is the power of God to salvation. Not a program. Listen, I'm all for good singing. Don't get me wrong. I love singing. And we can sing the gospel in our songs, and we should. But the Bible said he chose the foolishness. Amen.
Yeah.
He chose the foolishness of preaching. And we're to preach the gospel. We're to give the gospel out. We can do that with our mouths. We can do it with tracts. We can do it in many different ways. But we're to preach this gospel. It is the power of God. If somebody's going to get saved, they're going to get saved through the gospel. Yeah. Ain't no other way.
Right.
There is no other way. You can get baptized in the Jordan River all you want to. I made that one. Lord, I hope I ain't watching. Anyway, I was conversing. I'll do it without naming anybody. That might make it better. I was conversing with someone. And I said, we were talking about Israel and Mount. He said, well, y'all get baptized in the Jordan River. And I said, well, I'm not Catholic. And then I heard a little bit later, he said, I was baptized in the Jordan River. Hey, listen, the Jordan River can't wash away those.
Right, sure.
There ain't no other river can do it either.
Right.
This baptistry back here, we could put some good, clean, purified water in it, but it ain't going to wash away one sin.
Right.
The gospel can, though. It's the power of God and the salvation. That's what gets the job done. It's preaching of the gospel. It is the power of God. Strange how we try to change the things of God, isn't it? We're to preach it. It's the power of God. We're not to be ashamed of it. Who's this for? We've already preached this, but we'll say it again. He said, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. Everyone. Greek, barbarian, wise, unwise, white, black, yellow, red, purple. I don't care. You can be saved if you believe the gospel. Amen. You can be saved. You believe the gospel. You know what would fix all this mess that they're calling racism and all this mess? The gospel. Amen. There is not a race on earth that has been persecuted more for their race than the Jew. There's not nobody on earth that's been persecuted more than the Jew. But if a Jew would believe, he could be saved. I stopped at the gas station this afternoon, got some gas. And you know, everything's kind of heightened because of all the news, riots and all this stuff. And there's a colored fella pulled up right beside, a young guy, big old guy. He walked in, he come out, he just started talking to me. And we just had a conversation. Most of this mess up in these big cities, it's just a mess. They don't live where we live. A lot of these people, they're not, sin is the real problem here.
Right.
Race is not the problem here. I understand what that man did was wrong. Take him to the courts, prosecute him to the max.
Yeah.
Just like it was if it was the other way around.
Right.
Yeah. But listen, the gospel would solve that stuff. If these people that were running around rioting in the cities and looting and stealing and burning, if they would hear the gospel and believe, wouldn't be doing that stuff.
No.
They got a sin problem. Just like I had one. The gospel can change it. It's to everyone that believe it. It doesn't matter their race. It doesn't matter what nation they're from. It's to everybody. Everybody. Aren't you glad he just didn't keep it for the Jew?
Yeah.
None of us in here could be saved.
Right.
Unless you're a Jew, and I don't know about it. And if you are, thank God. I'm not bothered by that. It doesn't matter what color you are. It doesn't matter what race you are, what nation. To everyone that believes, faith is what is required to the Jew first and also to the Greek. God sent his son to the Jews first. They rejected him. He opened the door for the Gentiles. Thank God he did. There's been a few down through the years that's believed. Barbarians. One day, the Lord willing, I'll get to go to the Lord's Museum. Have you ever been there, Rebecca? The London Museum? No? Obviously not. you don't remember it anyway. I'm sorry, I'm kidding. You're new. I'm supposed to be there. They said, read it in a book one time, that in that London Museum, there's a bowl and a big club from a cannibal man who lived over in the Pacific Islands many years ago. And the missionary went there, preached the gospel to him, and that cannibal chief got saved. And as a symbol of his surrender to Christ, he took his bowl that he used to drink human blood with, and his big stick that he used to kill people with, and he sent them to England, saying, "I have believed the gospel. My life has changed." I'm saying God can save him. Amen. He can save him. He wants to save everybody. And it's the preaching of the gospel that will do it. Amen. It's the preaching of it. The heathen over in New Guinea need the gospel. The heathen in New York City need the gospel. The heathen in Italy need the gospel. Hey, the wise, the unwise, it doesn't make any difference. There's one central need, and that is forgiveness of sin. And the gospel can bring that if they just believe. So what are you saying? I'm saying we need to preach the gospel. Preach the gospel, preach the gospel, preach the gospel. We don't have to have a special service to preach the gospel.
Right.
Amen. There ought to be a little gospel in every service, it seems like to me.
Yep.
One thing I like about Brother Coker, when he comes and preaches for us sometime, he's going to preach the gospel. Somewhere, somehow. I like that. Amen. We need more preaching of the gospel. Let's all stand. Let's have every head bowed and every eye closed for just a moment. And I say not only do we need more preaching of the gospel, but we need more preachers of the gospel. We're not seeing people being called like we used to, or at least people not heeding the call. We need more preachers of the gospel. When God calls a man to preach, his first and foremost duty is to preach the gospel. We need more of that. We need more of that. Let's pray. Father, I pray you bless the message. Help us, Father, tonight to not be ashamed, but to preach the gospel without anything hindrance, without, Lord, thinking, Lord, that one deserves it more than another, or whatever the case might be, Lord. You said it's to the Greek, the Jew, the wise, to the unwise, the barbarians, whoever, they would just believe. Lord, I pray you'd help us to do that. I pray you'd help us to take the gospel to someone this week. Lord, help us to pray over it. That God, you put us in the path of someone that needs to hear the gospel, and that we'd be faithful to give it to them. And Lord, we'll thank you for what you do. I pray you bless your people this week. Bring us back Wednesday night, and Lord, we might be able to worship and praise you again, and pray and come together in the fellowship of this church. Lord, we love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Any other word before we dismiss tonight? All righty. I pray you be faithful this week, and let's pray for one another. I need your prayers. If you ain't got nobody to pray for, pray for me. I need it. Pray for each other. Pray for our missionaries. Pray especially for ours that are going out of our church for the hire of the gym, their families, the needs of the work in Scotland. You just pray. All right. God bless you. We'll be dismissed.